Today we're talking about the craziest skateboard shoes ever made. It's brands taking big risks. Sometimes it hits, sometimes it flops. We're gonna talk about the brand who made a full Velcro shoe, fully rubber shoes, helium-filled airbags, skateboard boots. And we're gonna look at some of the craziest shoes that have ever been made. What's up guys, my name's Levi, this is Shred Shop, connecting you to skateboarding, and today we're taking a look at 50 of the craziest skateboard shoes ever made. If you guys like videos about skateboarding, you're gonna love our channel. Make sure you like, subscribe, and comment, because we just hit 70,000 subscribers, and we're trying to hit 100,000 by Christmas. When Nike SB started in the skate world, they asked artist Todd Bratrude to draw a special version of a dunk. Bratrude was heavily involved with Consolidated Skateboards at the time, and they were not a fan of Nike. So in response, Consolidated let out an ad that said, "It is not a Consolidated shoe," making sure that everyone knew they weren't associated. They also let out their famous "Don't Do It" campaign, which was obviously a shot at Nike. And to take it a step further, Consolidated clapped back. They put out their own version of the shoes called the Consolidated BS Drunks. They also wanted to make fun of the hype of Nike SB, so in the launch of the shoe, they put it out saying only 650 pairs worldwide, and then they threw them on eBay and everywhere. Later, they also did an Osiris collab, and you can imagine how that went. In the early 90s, there's these guys that started a fully vegan skate shoe brand called Zero Two Shoes. The crazy thing about these shoes, they're fully vegan, but the whole upper was constructed of entirely Velcro. And then you could get these ollie patches that had Velcro on the back of them, and you could stick them on in your high wear areas. The funny thing is they ended up with a pretty good team. They were backed by Mike V and Ed Templeton. Speaking of Velcro though, in 2001, DC released the Solution shoe. It was designed by Danny Way and Colin McKay. This might be one of the most functional vert skate shoes of all time. The box that they were in boasted that it was the world's first ever laceless skateboard shoe. It might be pretty functional for vert, but I'd put it in the same category as lace covers. It doesn't look very good on a date. And then speaking of function over fashion, Eric Kosten let out his Kosten 3 on Nike SB, which was a sock shoe that led into a high top. The shoe design was based off of a soccer shoe design that Nike was using at the time. Basically, the idea was that if the shoe fit really snug in all areas, you had more spatial awareness of where your foot was at all times. Now, there's this brand called Ice Cream. It was Pharrell, the rapper, his skate shoe concept. He launched the brand kind of as a sub-brand under Reebok. So they started with huge financial backing. So even though it was a small company, they weren't gonna lose. They had a pretty sick team at the time. They had guys like Terry Kennedy, Jacob Wilder, and Jimmy Gorecki. It's also rumored that Pharrell signed TK to one of the first million-dollar shoe deals in skateboarding. The shoes never really popped off with skaters, but they were big in the sneakerhead world, and then eventually kind of just faded into nothing. But if you have a pair these days, they're worth at least $5 less than what you paid retail. In the early 2000s, being a hippie was kind of trending, and the rule was that you couldn't have dreadlocks unless you wore a pair of iPath Cats. When Osiris let out the D3, they had a couple years of slow sales, and everything was about to change. Eventually, some celebrities started to catch on, and they were wearing it. Most notably, Fred Durst. If you don't know who he is, he dated Christina Aguilera, and he was the lead guy from Limp Bizkit, one of the best bands that's ever lived on this planet. And then as the shoe took off in popularity, the follow-up, they released the D3 2001, which was even chunkier and more rubbery than ever. And this shoe became famous for every skater's dream girl in her music video, Avril Lavigne's Skater Boy. And then you've got people who are a little late to the trend. Pairing them up with their JNCO jeans, Billie Eilish has been rocking them lately. These are the dopest ones on this list, the Airwalk Gym Tennis Shoes. They are so dope. Let me tell you why they're dope. After the success of the Airwalk 1 shoe, the gym shoes came in and took over for the dopest. They basically took this model and they made it out of all the craziest materials you can think of. They made plastic ones, fully rubber ones, placenta skin. They made tennis shoe ones, and they made basketball ones. Seeing the entire line of those, you can't help but think that they had heavy influence for the Blondie McCoy Adidas Superstar shoes. When I'm not making Shreds videos, I'm at Sunday Barbershop. It's a space for good haircuts and good friendships. Come through, we'll geek on skating, and you'll leave with a fresh cut. Book at notopensunday.com. And speaking of rubbers, let's visit the land of rubber shoes. Let's start with Savior. This was a little startup skate shoe company out of Portland. But not long after they started, Nike came in and they bought them out. And this was Nike's second attempt into skateboarding. They designed some truly bomb-proof skate shoes, but realistically just couldn't make a go of it, and eventually Nike pulled the plug. They may have dropped the brand, but the technology kind of lived on. And we see it show up again when Nike SB launched, so the third attempt into skateboarding.
skateboarding.
This came out with the EQ shoe. We feel like it took a lot of inspiration from Sauvier. We know the history. Those two shoes walked so the Niger Free could run. When we talk about crazy shoe brands like Sauvier, we can't help but think of other brands like Vita. It was not a just footwear brand. They had a pretty stacked team, including Jason Dill. These shoe models were truly a gift to absolutely no one. Let's take a look. The funny thing is, as heinous as they look, they were associated with some of the biggest hitters in the skateboard world. Mark Albloh, Jason Dill, and Nottis. Those guys are all icons in their own right, but it clearly just didn't hit with Vita. Let's throw an honorable mention in there. Everyone's favorite non-skate skate shoes, soap shoes. You couldn't skate inside the hallways of your school, but you could soap shoe. There was a brand called Airspeed. Everything they created was subpar. It was owned by Walmart, and it was their take on skateboard shoes. But the funny thing is, they finessed a few amazing pros at that time, like Quim Cardona and Brian Sumner. Just shows you, if you got the cheddar, you can get it, baby. Next up, when you're talking about crazy shoes, you have to talk about Vans. In the 80s, they kind of lost their way, and they felt like they had to compete with sports shoe brands like Nike, Adidas, and Reebok. Like, they launched a full entire running line. They also made baseball cleats, football cleats, and even breakdancing shoes. And they even dipped into making skateboard wheels at one point. They were called Vanathane. I mean, they were kind of tripping about who they were. They even teamed up with a brand called ACS, and they made roller skates. And here's the kicker. They made clown shoes. They started making these shoes at $60 a pair, and they were so successful that they made them for 14 years. To put that price into perspective, a Vans Authentic at that time was $10. But the story goes deeper. After the sports era, two of the owners, Jim Van Doren and Paul Van Doren, weren't seeing eye to eye. Jim gets pushed out of the company, and he decides to start his own brand of knockoff Vans, and he called it Awesome Shoes. They look almost identical to Vans in every way. Another interesting trend is seeing skateboard deck companies that they get big enough thinking that they can survive in the shoe market. The thing is, it's apples and oranges. We've seen it over the years where we saw Burton buy out Habitat, and then they launched Habitat Footwear. They had all the factory connects through Gravis Footwear, which was owned by Burton, and so they could make a quality shoe. But a huge percentage of selling a skateboard shoe and making it cool is marketing, and it's a lot harder to do than a board brand. Other board brands that have done it over the years are Element, Santa Cruz, Hookups, Zero, World Industries, and Alva. Now let's talk real. What current deck brand do you think could pull off a shoe line today? Let us know below. Aeroc released a shoe for a pro they had named Victor Novetti-Pellet. They were letting all these ads and all this marketing, and people quickly found out that it was a fake guy, a fake pro, but it was a real shoe. The name Vic was a joke on the Australian slang term for victim of fashion. And these shoes live up to their name. They're loaded with extra lace covers and extra panels, and they are beautifully ugly. And to kick them while they're down, Aeroc made bowling shoes at the time too. And speaking of interesting characters, Simon Woodstock, he was a real person, but he was just as eccentric as Victor was. He had a pro model shoe on Vans that was actually pretty rad, but then he filmed tricks in a suit that was fully covered in pennies. He said when he filmed tricks in this suit, it was almost impossible to land them because the suit weighed so much, it was like wearing full armor while skateboarding. And we can talk controversy between people that are cool and people that are not cool. The next one up is the Dylan Gravis shoe and boot. When they first dropped, people were making fun of them, calling them like a Peter Pan boot. There was a lot of skeptics out there that didn't know what to think. But quickly, it became Gravis's best-selling shoe, and they were sought after and worn everywhere. They also did a high-top version of the slip-on. Now, in the late 90s, Aeroc shoe sales were slipping. They were dipping. And so they decided to launch a technical side to their shoe brand. And they called this sub-brand Genetic Footwear. And the ads were really creepy. The shoes were super tech, and they never really hit. But skateboarding got a Bucky Lassic Pro model under the brand. But by 2004, the brand closed up. In the 1980s, Harley-Davidson took a swing at making skateboard shoes. They named their shoes after their bikes, like the Sportster and the Heritage. They actually didn't look that bad, but were bummed that they didn't let out one called the Fat Boy. Just take all the tech from the D3. They could have just taken the Chet 5 and called it the Fat Boy. Nike's first attempt into skateboarding, they brought a pretty crazy team. They had Bam Margera, like when Bam was Bam was Bam. Some of their early shoes were called the Chode, the Snack, the Trog, and the Scream. And even with a superstar like Bam and all the money from Nike, they couldn't make it work. Bam even said at that time he was buying SXLs and putting a Nike swoosh on them because he couldn't even Chode up. The Adidas 3ST02, which was a technical slip-on, we had a pair of the FA collabs of these on the wall at the shop. A customer came in and they said, it looks like this shoe was designed after a toilet, which is actually kind of true for most people. I'll be honest, I love these shoes. Now get this. In Big Brother issue 30, Dave Carney designed his own pro model shoe. He designed it with genius creativity. The idea was bigger than himself. It had a bright pink prentice on the side. It has FU written on the foxing of the toe. There's a pentagram stitch on the side, random triangles on it for no reason. And for all you vegan, it was originally designed to be made fully of endangered animal skin. And it had an airbag full of Coors Light. You thought this was a joke, right? So did we. But two decades later, DC decided to team up with Big Brother. They made an almost identical replica of the shoe, although it didn't have endangered animal skin on it, and there was no Coors Light in the airbag. When DC made the first samples, the dick came out small and gray. Dave Carney said, "The wiener's gotta be bigger and it's gotta be pinker." Guys, these are the 50th craziest skateboard shoes ever made. You have to let us know which was the craziest, which was your favorite, and which one do they need to bring back? Let us know below. If you're on other platforms, so are we. It's at Shred Shop and at Levi Switzer. Guys, we just hit 70K subs and we're trying to hit 100,000. Like, subscribe, and comment. Help us out. We'll get there, make you better content. Stay tuned for comment of the week. Oh, we got a spicy one for you, my guys. Comment of the week. It's from a recent shoe review we did on the Rowan shoes. It's from my guy, Ricardo Galvo, 3603. He says, "Shoe looks like Levi's new hair. A bit weird. At Shreds, we all think the new Rowan shoe looks sick. And we all love my hair. All of us."